One of my favorite movies of all time, right behind Cyrano de Bergerac, is Tombstone. And it may not hit the intellectual charts, but there's a scene in that movie which I've never forgotten. It's where Wyatt Earp is riding out, hunting down the outlaw band that wears the red sashes around their arms. And he's tracking them down one after another until there's no place left for any of them to hide. And his best friend, Doc Holliday, is camped out with some other of the fellows who are in this endeavor. And someone says to him something along the lines that Wyatt is out to get revenge. And Doc Holliday says, "Make no mistake, it's not revenge he's after, it's the reckoning." And what he meant by that was that things had been thrown out of balance. Evil had been done, and it wasn't a matter of getting even with anybody. It was a matter of a proper settling of accounts. And when that was over, Wyatt Earp would ride off into the sunset. Well, the scripture passages that we've been reading today speak to us of a time when there will be a reckoning, and it will not be carried out by Wyatt Earp or any human authority, but it will be carried out on the day of the Lord, when every secret is laid open, where every wrong will be set right, where every injustice will be rectified, and it won't matter what human interventions are made, there will be a settling of accounts. We speak of this every Sunday in the Creed, when we say that we believe in Jesus Christ, who will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead. This is not talking about when we die and we go to heaven, although there will be a temporary arrangement of positions at that time. The Bible, from cover to cover, looks forward to a day which is called the Day of the Lord, when the books will be opened, when the accounts will be settled, when God is the King who knows all and is completely just, will mete out judgment according to what is right. There are a couple of things that were told about that day in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. It says to that church, which is different, I think, from us today, it says, "Concerning the times and seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you." Of course, maybe he's buttering them up, because after he tells them they don't need to have anything told to them, he goes ahead and then tells them what they need to know. So maybe I should put it that way. "Brothers and sisters, you have no need that I will talk to you about any of these things. But just in case you do," the apostle gives them two illustrations of how the Lord's coming will take place. First, he says it will be like a thief in the night. And that's an illustration that was used earlier in the Bible, but St. Paul recycles it here. How does a thief come in the night? Well, he doesn't come when you're expecting him. He doesn't wait until you're sitting on the front porch with your shotgun loaded in both barrels and watching. He waits until you're on vacation or you're asleep. And when you're asleep and you have no idea what's happening, then the thief breaks in and steals. Secondly, it will come like a woman's labor. I love all of our babies, but I did not love that last couple of months when I was nervous, when I felt like I needed to be ready at any moment to jump in the car and drive out to Sharon, or when I lived in the city, even worse, driving out to Long Island to the Long Island Jewish Medical Center, and I was always a little bit nervous because you never know when a woman's going to have a baby. It comes, the labor pains begin, and then it's all hustle and bustle and rush and ramble and scramble and get her to the doctor as quickly as you can. But it should not surprise us apostle means by that is that there is a way for us to be prepared that we can put in place such that we will always be ready. So that if Jesus comes today, or tonight, or tomorrow, or the next day, we will be prepared. And so he compares the Christians to the daytime. Or he says that we are people of the daytime. But it's a tricky metaphor that he uses because it's different from the way we think. He thinks of daytime as a sphere in which a certain group of people live all the time. And then there is night, which is a second sphere in which people live all the time. What goes on at night? Well, at night, people sleep, and those that get drunk generally tend to get drunk at night, and so their senses are dull, their mind is groggy, they're not ready, they're not ready to drive, they're not ready to jump to action, they're not ready for very much, but just kind of drifting off to sleep, which is the other thing that the apostle said is done at night. And so there's a whole group of people who morally are in the realm of sleepy land. But he said, you are not of the night, you are of the day. You are people of the daytime. And what is it like to be people of the daytime? Well, what it means is that you're aware of what's happening. You're alert. You are perceptive. You're keen. And he then gives us some instructions. And I think that from all of the scriptures we have read, there are a couple of things that we are called to do. We're technically part of the day, but in order to realistically reflect what is technically true of us, the apostle and I think Jesus makes some suggestions. The apostle Paul says, since we belong to the day, let us be sober. He's clear-minded. You've ever seen someone who's had too much to drink? They're no longer clear-minded. The emphasis here is the ability to be able to think clearly, perceive things well. And he says, put on the breastplate of faith and love. So, we are to be faithful and loving. Faithful to God, faithful to our vows, faithful to one another as brothers and sisters, and loving. We're to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourself, and to pursue that in a deliberate way. Do you think that way? Here's a business deal that's coming up. Here's a job opportunity that's opening up. Here's a potential relationship that might be available to me. You ask yourself, how can I reflect the love of God and my love of my fellow human being in this opportunity? And if there is no opportunity to do that there, then maybe I'd better look for another opportunity. But we trust in God, that's the faith aspect, and then we love God with all of our heart, mind, and strength, and we love our neighbor as ourselves. And that's the big, if you want to be protected what the police wear, their flak jacket thing, their name covers this section right here, because that's where all your vital organs are. In other words, if you put these two things on, you are mostly prepared right off the bat. Secondly, he says, put on a helmet, the hope of salvation. You see, if you're going to live for the future, it's very important that you have confidence that there is a reward waiting in the future. Nobody's very excited about investing in stocks that have very little chance of yielding a benefit, do they? Very few people want to buy a business and the owner says, well, you know, they never really made much money here, and I don't reckon we really ever will make much money here, but you can have my business for, $100,000. I wouldn't be very excited about buying that, would you? Christians have to live in the present
with an awareness that there is a future hope, that there is a day of the Lord. And while that day will be terrible for those who have lived their lives in opposition to Jesus Christ and his ways, it is a day that holds in store unfathomable rewards for those who love and serve him now. If you ever worked at a gas station as a kid, and you had a customer that whenever he came in, if you washed his windows and you checked his air pressure in his tires and were polite, and you knew that he always gave a generous tip, you wanted to be right on that car when he came in, didn't you? And that's what God is like. God is extremely generous. So don't lose in the threat of impending judgment for those who are opposed to God the absolute and wonderful promise of reward for those that belong to him. It will be the best day that there ever was for those who belong to Christ when Jesus comes again. Then it says, for God has destined us not for wrath, which I've just been emphasizing, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Now this awake or asleep is a different awake or asleep. It's another metaphor. In this metaphor, to be asleep means to be dead. And to be awake means to be alive. The early church described those Christians that had died as those who had fallen asleep. We have a couple of friends that come to our Bible study. They're from the Advent Christian group. They believe that you literally sleep until Jesus comes again. We believe that it's metaphorical. Your spirit is with God, your body is asleep in the ground. But when Jesus Christ comes again, the dead of Christ will rise and your spirit and your body will be reunited. And you will live forever in the eternal kingdom of God. And so our salvation is both now and not yet. You understand that? There is a point in our lives when we come to faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior. And when you trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior, what it means is this. We believe that through what Jesus Christ did on the cross, that something happened which involved a great transfer, such that our guilt was laid upon Jesus Christ, and he paid for it on the cross. So that God's wrath, which we deserve, will never be leveled against us, because Jesus Christ has paid it in full. And on the other hand, the righteousness which belonged to Jesus has been credited to us. It's as if Jesus' money was placed in our bank account, so that we are considered wealthy in righteousness, where before we were impoverished. I had a debt I could not pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. And the hope of that begins now, but it will be completed on the day of salvation, because on the day of salvation, our righteousness will not just be technical. Right now we are technically justified. God treats us just as if we had never sinned, even though those of us who are honest know that we have sinned, haven't we? And we sin all the time. And if God were to hold everything against us that we've ever done, we could never hold our head up. But he has chosen not to. He has technically justified us like a governor that pronounces a man innocent of murder. And he has given a pardon. Even though he was guilty. Even though he's guilty, no one can punish him. The police can't arrest him. The jailer can't jail him. The government can't fine him because he has been declared technically innocent. Now with that technical declaration, God begins to make us holy for real. But that process, which we call sanctification, will be complete on the day when Jesus Christ arrives. And when we see him, something is going to happen inside of us. Because when we see him perfectly as he is, the ancient people used to call it the beatific vision. There will be something about seeing him as he is that will change the way we are, so that we will become really righteous, completely righteous, and will never ever sin again. That's the hope that we look forward to. Don't you look forward to that? To the day that you will never have to feel in the slightest bit guilty, that you will never have a single regret or a tinge of remorse, because you will never again do the kind of things that we do now, or we have to come back to church every Sunday and say, Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. That's ahead of us. The effects of it begin now, but it will be completely realized in the not yet. Well, I want to remind you as we wrap this up of three things. As we face the day of the Lord, I want to point this out. First of all, we dare not face that reality with indifference. We read earlier in the Old Testament scripture, don't be among those who say, the Lord's not going to do us any good, and the Lord's not going to hurt us. In other words, God is really ultimately irrelevant. How many people have I asked, why don't we come to church anymore? Or wouldn't you like to come out and worship God? And I say, you know, the church is really just kind of irrelevant to my life. Well, I can tell you, it may seem irrelevant now, but there will come a day when there will be nothing else more relevant than your relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Don't be among those who say, God won't do me good, nor will God punish me. Secondly, we dare not face it with complacency. What does Jesus say? He says in his parable, I've given everybody a certain number of gifts. Talents is a measure of money, a measurement of silver, I believe, in the old economy. And what happened? Each one was given a certain amount. They were all different amounts. There was no fair distribution of this as we would think of it in modern times. One was given five, one was given three, one was given one. And the one who was given five went out and worked with it. I saved this for you guys. I know you like the children's sermons better than mine anyway. You know, every first Sunday of the month, Evie Granger takes her violin. God is giving her a talent. And she goes to where there are no teenagers, no children, nobody her age she could relate to. And she uses the talent that God has given her to play at the fountains. And those old folks are so blessed. She's doing exactly what Jesus said. And I believe that in this life, God is going to give her more to you if she keeps that up. And in the next life, she will have treasure laid up for heaven. The other day we had a bazaar. And there were at least two artists who contributed their painting. One is not even from our church. There's an artist, a Chinese fellow, Taiwanese, who painted these. And his sister brought, I don't know, perhaps 15 prints. And gave them to the church so that we could use them to raise money for missions here. His talents are being invested well and used well. What has God given you? Because as we live with the reality, there will be a day of reckoning in which God will ask you, what did you do with the money that I gave you? What did you do with all the love that I gave you? What did you do with the skill that I gave you? What did you do with it? I want to encourage you that what you invest in this world is very uncertain. Talking to a fellow yesterday that lost $60,000 in one of these market flips. It's a very uncertain place to put your hope. But there is a place where you can invest, where you can use your talents. It's called the Kingdom of God. And those investments will be there forever and multiply. And you notice something else? That he gave them an amount to begin with that was commensurate with their gift. But you notice that when they did well with it, something happened. He gave them twice as much the next time. Why? It seems to me that with the use of their talent, they grew in talent. And God gave them double the second time. And so there's an increase not only in the responsibility that God gives us, but in the ability that that goes together with them. There will be a day of reckoning. How does one prepare for it? First of all, by accepting the gift of salvation that's been offered us by Jesus Christ, without which nothing else will matter. Secondly, we must not be complacent. God will come, there will be a reckoning. The righteous will be rewarded, and the wicked will be punished. Thirdly, we may dare not face it with complacency. But we, even though we have received gifts freely, we are called upon to use those gifts dynamically. And eye has not seen, ear has not heard, no mind has ever conceived the glorious things that God has prepared for those who live in this manner.